This is Kurt Heisinger, accounting professor at Sierra College and author of Managerial Accounting. This video describes the impact of cash flow, qualitative factors, and ethical issues that are associated with long-term investment decisions. And we're really focusing on net present value and internal rate of return calculations and some of the other factors that we should weigh in determining whether to take on or reject a long-term investment decision. Let's start with the cash flows piece. So which basis of accounting is used to calculate, as I said, we're focusing on net present value and IRR, to calculate NPV and IRR for long-term investments, cash or accrual? Well, the answer to that is we use the cash basis of accounting when we are calculating the net present value and the internal rate of return. Not the accrual basis, but the cash basis. So non-cash items such as depreciation, and amortization are not included in the analysis, although depreciation and amortization can have an impact on the income tax cash flow, the income taxes that we ultimately have to pay. So in that sense, we do include them as they relate to the income tax cash flow. And I talk about that in a separate lecture where we get into income taxes, companies that have income taxes, and how to factor that into net present value and internal rate of return analysis. Another factor that we have to consider when we're looking at net present value and internal rate of return calculations is inflation. And the question here is inflation included in cash flow projections when we calculate NPV and IRR? The answer to that is most managers do make cash flow projections that include an adjustment for inflation. So if we're looking at cash flow related to revenue or sales over time, we need to look at and factor in inflation with those projections. And as an important point here, the cash flow projections do have to include adjustments for inflation to match the required rate of return, which already factors in inflation. So we just have to be matching apples with apples. If we have inflation factored into our cash flows, we also have to have inflation included with our required rate of return. So the assumption that we're going to make is that all examples will have cash flows that factor in inflation and will have required rates of return that also are adjusted for inflation. So we don't want to leave our net present value and internal rate of return analysis simply by looking at numbers and leave it with numbers. We also want to consider qualitative factors. So we'll talk about what those qualitative factors, what we mean by qualitative factors, and why they should be considered in this slide. So qualitative factors are non-financial factors that management should consider. In addition to NPV and IRR, both of those methods include financial data. So now we're talking about non-financial information. What are some examples then of qualitative factors that companies may want to consider? Well, it might be that investing in technology is strategically important for us as a company, even though we may not see the numbers yielding a positive net present value or an internal rate of return that is greater than our required rate of return. There may be some technology we want to invest in, and it's strategically very important to our company. Also, it may be that we want to maintain a reputation as the industry leader in innovation. So we'll continue to put resources into innovating new products. For example, maybe we are Apple and we want to create the latest, greatest iPhone, and we want to put some dollars into that. It may be that sales of iPhones are declining, but at the same time, we want to continue trying to be the leader in the industry in terms of innovation. So we're going to put some resources into that, what we call research and development, even though the numbers may not yield results that say we should do that in terms of net present value and internal rate of return. There's some other considerations, qualitative factors as well. These are just some examples. There can be many, many more qualitative factors. Might be that we're looking at the social benefits of investing in long-term investments, such as in our manufacturing facilities, making sure we have pollution devices in place so we don't pollute any more than we have to. And then lastly, providing new product lines to draw customers maybe to other more profitable product lines. So maybe we have new product lines that don't make us very much money, but the hope is over time our customers will stay with us and continue to buy our products in other areas that are more profitable for us. So those are just some examples of qualitative factors that we should consider above and beyond simply the numerical information. And as I mentioned earlier, managers must consider both quantitative and qualitative factors when making long-term investment decisions. Now let's take a look at some ethical issues that might crop up when we are looking at investing or making long-term investment decisions. So the question here is, when might managers make long-term investment decisions that are not necessarily in the best interest of the company? Well, it may be, this is just one example here, it may be that there's been a significant amount of work done on getting a long-term investment project in place, and managers have a vested interest in seeing that happen, regardless of the NPV and IRR results. So that certainly will create a conflict where managers, they call these pet projects. Managers may have pet projects that they want to see continue on, even though the numbers and the qualitative factors as well, don't show that they should continue on with those long-term investment proposals. Another ethical issue that may crop up is that managers oftentimes are evaluated based on short-term results. Maybe it's over the next four quarters or the next couple of years, but not over 5 to 10 to 20 years. And so the manager may choose, or managers may choose to reject a project because in the short term it will hurt the profitability or perhaps the results that are used to evaluate those managers. But in the long term, it may benefit the company. And what will happen then, oftentimes, is managers will reject the project because of that, even though it's in the best interest of the company to take on that project. So that can be an issue for companies, and it can be an ethical issue for managers as well. So how might ethical conflicts be prevented, especially when we're talking about assessing long-term investments using net present value and internal rate of return calculations? Well, sometimes managers, because they want to see a project continue, even though the numbers initially don't show that they should, they may exaggerate the cash flows that are associated with the long-term investment to be able to get a net present value that shows that they should take on the project. So one way to prevent that is to conduct what's called a post-audit, which compares the original capital budget, the original cash flow projections, that is, with what actually happened. So after the fact, look back a little bit and see, how did the budget compare to the actual results? And let's reward managers that are very good at putting together accurate capital budgets. The second bullet point that you see here is when we talk about managers that tend to want to reject projects that affect them in the short term but would help the company in the long term, well, what we can do to help solve that problem is to design a compensation package that encourages managers to consider long-term profitability. And one of the ways to do that, there are many, but one of the ways to do that is to provide part ownership in the company, perhaps using stock options. So provide stock options to managers, and that will then give them an incentive to increase the value of the company over the long term rather than just in the short term. There are many other ways to provide an incentive for managers to align their interest with the company's interest, and that really ultimately is what we want to do as a company, is to make sure that managers have an incentive to do what is not only best for them, but also what is best for the company. And that can be done through different incentive compensation packages, and it's all about trying to create the package that will provide an incentive for our managers to do what's best for them and the company.